morning message, the Resurrection Sunday morning message, I've entitled it, They Didn't Understand. They didn't understand. Father, pray now in the next several minutes that we will go from not understanding to understanding. That we will recognize that perhaps this is the greatest day in history. In my opinion, it is the day that Jesus resurrected from the dead. I thank you for each person here. I ask, Holy Spirit, now that you would even come in a more powerful way. You invited each person here. Let them not miss what you want them to understand. And I just thank you for what you're going to do now. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's get play the video. Easter is simply that Jesus is alive. That there is hope, that our lives here have meaning, and that the best is yet to come for those of us who are believers and have followed Jesus Christ. There's no greater news, there's no greater message in all the world that Jesus is alive. And if you know Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, then you have tremendous, tremendous hope. Now this morning I want to start off from a story from college football folklore. There was this college football team, and their starting quarterback had gone down due to injury. And the second string quarterback was sick. In fact, he was so sick that he did not even dress for the game. So the only quarterback left on the team was a young freshman. In fact, he had played quarterback in high school, but he was now the college team's starting punter. And to make matters worse, the team was backed up to its own 3-yard line, and it was second down. The situation looked bleak, and the coach, he grabbed the young freshman quarterback before letting him go into the game, and he gave him these instructions. He said, "Son, see that big fullback out there, Kowalski? I want you to hand the ball off to him on the first two plays. Hopefully he can get enough yardage to give us a little breathing room, and then on your third play, I want you to drop back, and I want you to punt the football. Do you got that, son?" And the young freshman quarterback said, "No problem, coach, I can do that." And the young quarterback did just as the coach had instructed. On the first play, he handed the ball off to the big fullback, Kowalski. And believe it or not, there was a little hole. Kowalski shot it right through it. He ran for 50 yards. And the crowd was going crazy. The team huddled up, and the quarterback called the exact same play. And he took the snap from the center, and he handed the ball off to the big fullback, Kowalski. And miracle of miracles, he found light, and he ran for another 45 yards. And the crowd was just going just ballistic. They couldn't believe it. Two plays, 95 yards. Now the ball was on the opponent's 2-yard line. It was first down, and it was go to goal. Confidently, the team lines up. The quarterback takes the snap. He drops back the young freshman quarterback, and then he punts the ball into the end zone. The stadium is stunned, and as the team is just walking off dejectedly off the field, the coach grabs the young freshman quarterback, and he says, "Son, what in the world were you thinking when you called that play?" And the young freshman quarterback said, "I was thinking, boy, we have a dumb coach." Some of you might get that, some of you might not. Now that story sounds ridiculous, but believe it or not, if you know anything about football, not only in the college ranks, but quite often even in the pro ranks, the coaches do not allow the quarterbacks to make a decision. In fact, they call all of the plays from the bench. They just send them right on in through some kind of runner or player. And this morning, though, I want you to know that God, the God of the universe, has paid each one of us the highest compliment, the ultimate compliment. He allows each one of us to make our own decisions. The Bible tells us that God created us in His own image. And part of that image is He's given each one of us the ability to understand, to think, and to choose. But I want you to understand something. God will hold each one of us responsible for our choices. And this morning, each and every single one of us is going to have to choose. So with this in mind, turn with me to the book of Luke chapter 18 if you have your Bibles. Luke chapter 18, verse 31 says this, taking the 12 disciples aside, Jesus said, listen, we're going up to Jerusalem where all the predictions of the prophets concerning the Son of Man will come true. Now, believe it or not, there's over 300 predictions. There's 300 prophecies concerning the Messiah in the Old Testament. And many of those prophecies, many of those predictions deal not only with the Messiah's death, but also the resurrection. Now, let me set up the point that I'm trying to make with this true story. There was a Soviet double agent by the name of Condor. Condor was a World War II traitor who sold atomic secrets to the Soviets, and then he fled to Mexico City. Condor's conspirators arranged to help him by planning a meeting with the secretary of the Russian ambassador in Mexico City. The big problem was neither one of them knew what each other looked like, and they were both going to be wearing disguises. So it was agreed that Condor would identify himself with five prearranged signs. These five prearranged signs would be given both to Condor and to the Russian secretary. No one else would have these prearranged signs except one conspirator who gave both Condor and the Russian secretary these instructions. Here were the five prearranged signs. Sign number one. Once in Mexico City, Condor was to write a note to the Russian secretary signing his name as I. Jackson. Sign number two, after 3 days, Condor was to go to the Plaza de Colón in Mexico City exactly at 12 noon. Sign number three, Condor was to stand before the statue of Columbus. Sign number four, Condor was to have his middle finger placed in a Mexico guidebook. And finally, sign number five, Condor, when approached, was to say, isn't it a magnificent statue? I am from Oklahoma. History records that the Russian secretary not only gave Condor a passport, but an airline ticket, and he made it safely into Russia. Now here, I have two questions for you I want you to think about. The first question is this. Was it possible for anyone else to have faked being Condor? Question number two. Is it possible for the Russian secretary not to identify Condor as a defecting spy? I think the answer is obvious no to both of those questions. It would have been virtually impossible for anyone else to fake being Condor, and there was a 99.9% chance that the Russian secretary would identify him and him alone as Condor. Now, here's my point. I told you earlier, there's over 300 prearranged signs in the Old Testament identifying who the Messiah would be. This morning, in the remaining minutes that we have, I just want to give you six of those prearranged signs pertaining to the Messiah's death. Here they are. Now remember, these prearranged signs were given hundreds, literally hundreds of years before Jesus Christ stepped on planet Earth. Sign number one, prearranged sign number one, the Messiah would die by crucifixion. In Psalm 22:16, King David, 1,000 years before Jesus Christ was born, he gave this word, this sign in Psalm 22:16. My enemies surround me like a pack of dogs. An evil gang closes in on me. They have pierced my hands and my feet. Do you realize that when King David wrote these words in 1000 BC, crucifixion hadn't even been invented yet. It wouldn't be invented for another 300 years by the Assyrians. Yet 1000 years later, after King David wrote those words in Psalm 22, the Apostle John, a disciple of Jesus, wrote in John chapter 20 and verse 27 that the Roman soldiers, and John eyewitnesses, the Roman soldiers gathered around Jesus and they drove large nails into his hands and into his feet. Skip, can you put up the picture? Prearranged sign number two. The Messiah would be betrayed by a friend. In Psalm 41:9, a psalm, again, written by King David, 1,000 years before Jesus Christ walked planet Earth, David wrote these sad and sobering words. Even my best friend, the one I trusted completely, the one who shared my food, has turned against me. In the book of Mark, in the Gospel of Mark, chapter 14, it tells us that one of Jesus' disciples, Judas Iscariot, a name that shall live in infamy, went to the Jewish authorities and he betrayed Jesus. And then he led those Jewish authorities to the Garden of Gethsemane, and there Judas Iscariot betrayed Jesus with a kiss. Skip, can you put that picture up? Prearranged sign number three. The Messiah would be betrayed by 30 pieces of silver. Not 29, not 31, but 30 pieces of silver. The Old Testament prophet Zechariah, 500 years before Jesus Christ came to this planet, he wrote in Zechariah chapter 11, verse 12, "And I said to them," the I being the good shepherd, the Messiah, "and I said to them, if you like, give me my wages, whatever I'm worth, but only if you want to." So they counted out for my wages 30 pieces of silver. In John chapter 13, we are told that Satan entered Judas. And Judas Iscariot went out into the night. And then Matthew tells us in Matthew's Gospel in chapter 26 that Judas went to the leading priests, the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and they counted out for Judas not 29 pieces of silver, not 31 pieces of silver, but exactly 30 pieces of silver. Skip, can you put up the picture? Prearranged sign number four. The soldiers who crucified the Messiah would gamble for his garments. In Psalm 22:18, King David, again, 1,000 years before Jesus Christ was crucified, wrote this. Now listen to this. They, that is the soldiers, divide my garments among themselves, and they throw dice for my clothing. Even the seemingly tiny, tiny detail came to pass. For we are told in the book of Mark in chapter 15 that after the Roman soldiers crucified Jesus, they divided up his clothes. But because his outer garment was seamless, they threw dice to see which one of them would get the prize. Skip, can you put up the picture? Prearranged sign number five. The Messiah would be buried in a rich man's tomb or grave. The great Hebrew prophet, perhaps the greatest of the Old Testament prophets, 700 years before Jesus was born, Isaiah wrote movingly in Isaiah 53:9, "He, the Messiah, had done no wrong and never deceived anyone, but he was buried like a criminal and he was put into a rich man's grave." 700 years later, as Jesus Christ hung dying on that Roman cross, not paying for his own sin, but paying for your sin, and your sin, and your sin, and your sin, and my sin, and the sin of the whole world, suddenly Jesus cried out, "It is finished." And then we are told in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 27 that a wealthy man, Joseph of Arimathea, one of the members of the Sanhedrin, took Jesus' body down from the cross, and he laid Jesus' body in his new, expensive tomb. Skip, can you put up that picture? And finally, I want to give you prearranged sign number six. The Messiah would resurrect from the dead. Yes, it was predicted in the Old Testament that the Messiah would resurrect from the dead. 1,000 before Jesus' crucifixion and death, King David wrote this in the Messiah, Psalm 16:10. For you, that is God the Father, will not leave my soul, that is the Messiah speaking, among the dead, nor allow your Holy One to rot in the grave. The scriptures tell us that Jesus died on a Roman cross, that he was buried in a rich man's tomb. And then Matthew, on the third day, a disciple of Jesus, he writes in Matthew 28:9 that he tells us that Jesus Christ came out of his tomb. Matthew was there. He saw Jesus resurrected from the dead. And Matthew says that he's alive forevermore.
Hallelujah.
Skip, can you put up the picture? Jesus, I want you to know, fulfilled all six of those pre-arranged signs. All six of them. Here's two questions I have for you. Do you know of anyone else who fulfilled those six pre-arranged signs? Can you think of anyone else? Question number two. Is it possible for anyone else in the past or in the future to fulfill those six pre-arranged signs? The answer is no, and I'll tell you why. I'll give you a seventh pre-arranged sign of the Messiah. It's talked about in the Old Testament that the Messiah would come from the tribe of Judah. He'd be from the family of David. And interestingly enough, in 70 AD, the Roman soldiers came and they destroyed Jerusalem. They laid it to waste and they destroyed the Hall of Records. Do you know that it would be impossible for anyone since 70 AD to ever prove that they were the Messiah? That they were in the line of David because the Hall of Records were completely destroyed. I'm here to tell you this morning that if Jesus Christ is not the Messiah, the divine Messiah, God robed in humanity, then no one can be the Messiah, period. Now, here's what I want you to catch as we run down here, all right? I want you to see, though, the disciples' response to Jesus. It's kind of fascinating. Skip, can you quickly put up those scriptures? Luke chapter 18, verses 31 through 34. Now watch, taking the 12 disciples aside, remember, he's going up to Jerusalem. Listen, we're going up to Jerusalem where all the predictions of the prophets concerning the Son of Man will come true. He will be handed over to the Romans. He will be mocked, treated shamefully, and spit upon. They will flog him with a whip and kill him. But on the third day, he will rise again. But they didn't understand any of this. The significance of his words were hidden from them, and they failed to grasp what Jesus was talking about. So Jesus starts, here's the scene, Jesus starts to go through the Old Testament prophecies. Many of them I just gave you. Jesus says, boys, I'm going to go up to Jerusalem. And the disciples say, yeah, we got that, Jesus. Roger that. Then Jesus says, I'm going to be betrayed. Roger that, Jesus. That's in the scripture. Then Jesus says to the disciples, I'm going to be arrested. Okay. Then Jesus says to him, I'm going to suffer. All right, got it. Roger. Then Jesus says, I'm going to be crucified. You got it, Jesus. That's in the Old Testament scripture. And then Jesus says to him, and then on the third day, I'm going to resurrect from the dead. And it says in the scriptures that the disciples didn't get it. Literally in the Greek, they were stupid. I mean, I know, I thought about that. What in the world could they not understand? Jesus was crystal clear. Why in the world? No, I really, it bothered me. Why in the world didn't they understand? And the disturbing answer is this, because they had already determined in their hearts what the Messiah was to do. Have you ever already made up your mind about something? See, essentially what the disciples were saying is, Jesus, don't confuse us with the facts. We've already made up our minds. We know that when the Messiah comes, he will be a conquering king, not a crucified one. And do you know what the result was? Now, here's what I want you to get. It's very practical. Do you know what the result was of the disciples' misunderstanding and wrong thinking? When Jesus was arrested on that Thursday night, what happened to the disciples? They fled. And then if you look at the scriptures, this is what makes the scriptures amazing, because the disciples don't build themselves up. It said they spent the rest of their time hovering behind closed doors. They lived in fear. Hear me on this. If you believe lies and you live in lies, you will live in fear. If you believe lies, if you live in lies, you will live in fear. And that is sadly where most of the people of the world live. And I want you to know that fear will rob you of your life. But do you know what broke through the delusion, the bad, the false thinking, the lies of the disciples? I mean, something changed. And it was the resurrection of Jesus. It took the resurrection of Jesus to break through these lies, and something, oh no, something beautiful, something awesome happened. These men went from fear, cowards, to men of courage, faith. In fact, history says one by one, outside of the Bible, one by one, these disciples went to their deaths willingly. They willingly sacrificed their lives for Jesus Christ and his kingdom. They went to their deaths with great hope because they no longer feared anything that this world could do to them. They had seen Jesus risen from the dead, and nothing could convince them. Contrary, in fact, listen to what history tells us about how the disciples died. Simon, called Peter, died in Rome, crucified, head downwards because he felt he was unworthy to die as Jesus did. James, the son of Zebedee, was killed by an executioner's sword. Andrew, after preaching to the Scythians, was crucified like his brother Peter. Thomas went to India proclaiming Jesus' resurrection and was thrust through with pine spears. Philip evangelized in Phrygia, where hostile Jews had him tortured and then crucified. Matthew, after writing his gospel, was beheaded and nagged to Var. Nathanael, unwilling to recant his proclamation of a risen Christ, was filleted and then he was crucified. James the Lesser was beaten to death with a club. Jude, after writing his letter, was crucified in Persia. Simon the Zealot was also crucified. John was thrown into a boiling oil only to survive, and then later was banished to the island of Patmos. And finally, the Apostle Paul was beheaded in Rome after testifying to the Roman Caesar Nero. He said, "Caesar, you're not God, you're not Lord, Jesus is." And then Nero put air between his head and his soldiers. Yes, I want you to know that these men went willingly to their deaths. They went to their deaths with great, great hope because they saw Jesus alive and they no longer feared death. This morning, I want you to know that Jesus Christ is alive. If you don't know anything else, Jesus Christ is alive. And if you are a follower of Jesus, he makes some incredible promises to you and to I. He says, "I want you to know, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I will always be with you. My grace is sufficient for you. I don't know what you're going through this morning, but if Jesus were standing right here, he'd say, I want you to know that my grace is sufficient for your situation, that my power is made perfect in your weakness." And Jesus said, would save you. Look around you. No, look around you. Look all around you. I want you to know that everything that you see is going to burn. It's all passing away. But I want you to know that my kingdom is eternal. My kingdom is coming. And you shall rule and you shall reign with me. You have a great inheritance coming. You have a great hope that is coming if you believe. You know what makes Easter so great? What makes Easter so great is you don't have to live in fear. Men, more than anybody else, live in stark fear. They express it as anger, but they live in fear. Let me tell you something. I said you're going to have to make a choice, and here's your choice. You can live in fear. No, you can live in fear and die in fear, or you can live in faith. You can live in faith. You can place yourself, your commitment fully on Jesus and become alive. Come alive. Because the best is yet to come for you. I end with this story. It's a true story, actually. It's not a preacher's story. There was this older woman. She went to a doctor. She had been feeling well for a while. She found out that she had terminal cancer. She was so old that, you know, they determined to do nothing. The doctor told her, well, essentially you're going to die within 3 months. And so this dear old saint, she called her pastor to her home and told him the news. And he was saddened by the news. And then the woman said, the dear old saint, she said, "I'd like to actually prepare my funeral service beforehand." And so the minister sat down and she told him the scriptures that she wanted read at her funeral service. She talked about the various songs that she just absolutely loved. She even told the pastor what to preach, you know. He didn't mind that. And after they finished, he prayed. Oh, and she said, by the way, I also want to be, you know, I have a blue dress. And she brought out the blue dress. And I want to be buried in my blue dress. I want that in the coffin as people are looking at it. And then, of course, I want my favorite Bible. You know my favorite Bible. I want it in my left hand. And then the pastor prayed. And as he was about to leave, she said, oh, one more thing. Can you make sure that there's a fork in my right hand? Pastor looked a little confused, and she could see that. She said, I can see that, you know, confuses you, doesn't it? And he shook his head, yes, it does. Yes, it does. And she said, well, let me explain that to you. She goes, you know, I always just love those church potlucks. Those potluck dinners were just so awesome. And she goes, but my favorite part was when someone would come by, and they would pick up my plate, and then they would whisper in my ear, but hold on to your fork, they would say. She goes, I just love that, because she knew, she said, I knew something good was coming, like a deep dish apple pie, or maybe a nice chocolate cake. She goes, I just love that. And she goes to the pastor, and the pastor now had a smile on his face. She goes, on the day of my funeral, as the people are passing by and they see a fork in my right hand and you hear him whispering, what is with the fork? You tell them what the fork means. You tell them that the fork means the best is yet to come for those who have placed their faith and trust in Jesus. So the day of the funeral came. I'm not done yet. The day of the funeral comes. It's open casket. There she is in her blue dress. She has her Bible in her left hand and she's got her fork in her right hand. Can you imagine that? People are just passing by. And the minister is very close and he hears the people going, what's the fork for? What in the world is a fork for? Finally, the service started. It came time for the pastor to give his message. And he explained the story of the fork. And then he said, once I've heard that story, he goes, I've never been able to get that story out of my mind. So I want you to know, he said, I got my fork. I got my fork. Because this fork reminds me that Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. And that means that I'm going to be alive forevermore. And then he said, I got my fork. Do you have your fork? Father, there is no greater message. The good news is that Jesus is alive, that the love of God is real, that there is forgiveness for those who have sinned and find themselves crushed under the weight of guilt, that it all can be forgiven by the great God who came in the flesh, Jesus Christ, and died for our sins so that we could rise and live forevermore. And I pray that no one walk out of here depressed, discouraged, downtrodden. Holy Spirit, in this last song, begin to move in a powerful, powerful way. As we hear this one song on the screen and then sing this final song. And I ask for this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Skip, can you play that final song?
Hear the bells ringing, they're singing that you can be born again. The bells ringing, they're singing, Christ is risen from the dead. The angel upon the tombstone said he has risen, just as he said. Quickly now, go tell his disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. Joy to the world, he is risen, hallelujah. sing that you can be healed right now. Hear the bells ringing, they're singing, Christ, He will reveal it now. The angels, they all surround us, and they are ministering Jesus' power. It, but this could be your glorious hour. Joy to the world, He is risen. Alleluia, He's risen. Alleluia, He's risen. Alleluia. Disciples, that Jesus Christ is no longer